Packet analysis with Wireshark can be really hard. I'm sure you've felt that way. After all, the things that we're looking for at the packet level are pretty detailed. We're going down to the microscopic detailed binary view to answer some of the questions for the traffic we have on our networks. But there's also things that we do as analysts that can make this even harder. And in this video, I'm gonna go over the top 5 mistakes that we make as analysts that complicate our analysis with Wireshark. Let's go to the first one. Our pcaps are just too big. Now I've worked with some people that they install Wireshark in a certain area, they hit capture, they walk away, and then they just let that capture build and build and build. They come back later and then they got a whole terabyte of traffic to try to sift through. Well, you don't have to be a Wireshark expert to know that it doesn't do very well past about a gigabyte of data. So what can we do? Well, from the get-go, if we make our pcap smaller, it can be a lot simpler when we go back through and we do our analysis. What I do is I often set up what's called a ring buffer when I'm doing longer term captures. This means that I give Wireshark some parameters. I say, okay, I'm going to capture 500 megabyte files and I'm going to capture 100 of them and then I'm going to hit start. What that will do is it'll store that traffic into those files and it will write a new one every 500 megabytes. When the problem happens, now I can go back to the one that was running at the time of the event and I have a much smaller data set to work with. The second mistake we can make as analysts is having a very noisy machine under test. You ever go to do a pcap of someone's machine and you see that they have a browser open, it's got 100 tabs open, they're listening to music, they're watching YouTube, they're doing email, and then now you're trying to get a capture of a problem that they're experiencing? What do we do? Let's shut down all that noise. Close everything down. Close down email, close down Spotify, close down YouTube. Make it to where that machine is transmitting as little as possible, and then that will make sure you have less traffic to have to dig through in the pcap. The third thing is chasing false alarms in the packet capture. And here's what I mean by that. Sometimes we run across things in our pcaps and we go down these rabbit holes, spending a whole lot of time with things that are not related to the true issue that we're troubleshooting. I'm gonna show you 3 of those. The first false alarm is duplicate packets. Now here we can see every single packet has a black line after it. I see one packet, then I see a retransmission, see another packet, then a dupack, then a retransmission. I've had people call me and say, Chris, my network is falling apart. It's being ripped apart at the seams. What do I do? Well, here, let's just back up for a moment. If I take a look at the first packet and I take a look at the IP identification number, here I can see that this is 5722. If I go to the very next packet, which happened almost immediately, I can see exactly the same IP identification number. That means that I caught the same packet twice. This is really easy to do when I'm capturing on a span port, especially when I feed multiple interfaces over to my monitor port. It's easy to catch a packet when it's coming into the switch, copy it, and then when it's leaving the switch, get another copy. So duplicate packets are a false alarm that we want to make sure that we watch out for. The next false alarm would be so-called oversized packets. Now I fell prey to this one too, so don't worry if it's gotten you. Let's take a look at it from a packet capture perspective. If I come in here, check out our segment size. Now notice that this is just a conversation, it's a TCP conversation, but notice one station is sending these packets that are 14,000 bytes long. Now, how is it possible I can have a segment that's longer than the network MTU? Well, that could really catch my attention, and I could spend a lot of time coming in and trying to troubleshoot these so-called jumbo frames. In reality, all this is that the packet capture driver captured this before the data was segmented. All it means is the station is doing segmentation offloading. So instead of TCP doing the segmentation, breaking up the data into smaller pieces, that just means that after the point of capture, the NIC itself is actually doing the segmentation. So had we captured on the network off of either a tap or a span, we wouldn't see these really large frames. Instead, we would see that MTU being respected by the packets. And another false alarm, this is one that I commonly hear as well, are really small TCP windows. Let me show you what I mean. If I take a look here, I have a TCP conversation happening between endpoints. And if I just take a look at this first packet and I come down, now this is a device that looks like it's acknowledging data, or better yet, why don't I jump down a little further here? If I take a look at this packet and I come down to my TCP window, I can see that I only have a window size of 244 bytes. That means that this station cannot receive any more than 244 bytes at once. That's tremendously small. So we might be thinking, oh, I have no window. Let's look into TCP. Let's see what's going on here. when in fact, all this means is that we missed the TCP handshake. Now, up in the TCP handshake, very likely there was a window scale that was exchanged between the two endpoints that would greatly multiply this number. In fact, this number is probably well over 100K, but because we missed the handshake, Wireshark doesn't know how to multiply this number. That's why it's telling us the window size scaling factor is unknown. So this is not the true window in this conversation. Now there's other false alarms that we can run into in Wireshark, but those are definitely some of the big ones. All right, the fourth mistake we can make is capturing traffic in the wrong place. See, we can assume that we know where traffic goes. Maybe we plug into a switch and we think that we have a proper span set up, or we think we know which server a client is communicating with when in fact it's talking to a different one. So particularly in a switched environment, we want to make sure that we get our packet capture device in the right place. And we do that largely by either using a tap to actually break the connection somewhere along the network path, or we can use a span and make sure that we path the appropriate traffic over to our monitor port. And the fifth mistake it's easy to make as analysts is not being able to duplicate the problem. Can't tell you how many times I've gone out to a client and we just cannot get the problem to happen again. It's intermittent. So in those cases, what we have to do is set up packet capture that's ongoing. Just like we talked about with problem number one, we want to get those ring buffers going to be able to capture traffic all the time. And when the event does happen, we were in the right place at the right time to properly capture it. Now, one other thing that can make it harder for us to do our analysis is not setting filters properly. So go ahead and click this video over here and learn more about how to properly filter with Wireshark.